I was in a meeting recently, well, it was over in the South Pacific, and had this talk, and during the meeting, a woman said, "Oh, but the ship is going through." I said, "Yes, ma'am, the ship is going through." But I said, "What is the ship?" And she said, "It's the denomination, it's going to go right on through." And I said, "Ma'am, has apostasy ever gone through? Will apostasy dwell in a heavenly and holy place?" She didn't answer, because she didn't have an answer. Apostasy will not go through. It will not go through. And unfortunately and tragically, the Adventist Catholic connection is not going to end in the New Jerusalem. It's going to end in the Lake of Fire. Amen. It's that simple. It's that simple. So, let's take a look at the Adventist Catholic connection. A lot of people ask, why are there independent ministries? Is it because there's a bunch of people that have chips on their shoulders? You know, I've had people say that. You know, the reason you're a Seventh-day Adventist and you're not a part of the denomination is because you're angry at how you were treated. Well, is that true? Is that true? Is it because people are holding grudges and just can't find it in their heart to forgive? Is it a personal thing, or is there another reason? You know, I worked for a man many years ago by the name of John Osborne. And I want you to understand, on this first slide, I do mention a few people's names. I mentioned John Osborne and I mentioned Walter Veith. Now, folk, I worked with John Osborne for 2 years, and Walter Veith gave the ministry that I have the go-ahead. We have probably duplicated 25 to 50,000 of his DVDs and sent them all over the world. Amen. So, you know, is Walter Veith doing a great work? Absolutely he is. Amen. Absolutely he is. Did John Osborne, when he was at Prophecy Countdown, did he do a great work?
Yes.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. But, so I'm dealing here with an issue. I have nothing against John Osborne. I have nothing against Walter Veith. Just dealing with an issue. And I hope you can distinguish that. But John Osborne wrote a book after he returned to the denomination. It was called Back on Track, in which he described his going back to the denomination because he let his anger take him away. And in the back of his book, he then went on to talk about me, because it was in the time when I was at Prophecy Countdown, right sometime after that, that he went back. And John said in his book that the reason Bill Hughes was independent was because he had anger issues as well. And so I asked the question, is that true? Walter Veith has been doing a series, it's called The Total Transformation, in which he is telling independent people to return to the denomination. I've had people from all over the country that have called and told me about this series. He wants them to bury the hatchet. Is anger management really the issue, or is there something else, something far deeper than this? Let's allow another story in another time to fill in the details. You know, after King Solomon died, his son came into power. His name was Rehoboam. And Rehoboam made some very poor decisions. And so the 10 northern tribes of Israel broke away from the 2 tribes of Judah and Benjamin. And after Jeroboam reigned for a while, there was a succession of evil kings, till finally a man came to the throne by the name of Ahab. And he's probably one of the more well-known kings in Israel. Now, he was a descendant of Abraham, at least by family relation, so he was considered to be one of God's people. And in form, Ahab kept the seventh-day Sabbath, at least before he married Jezebel. He kept the seventh-day Sabbath. And he espoused the belief, like all Israelites, in the coming of the Messiah. So, if Ahab were alive today, what would we call him? We call him a Seventh-day Adventist. Seventh day, kept the seventh day, looked forward to the Messiah's coming. So he was a Seventh-day Adventist. Now this Seventh-day Adventist leader made some very bad choices. Probably the worst one of all was his union in marriage with Jezebel, the daughter of Ethbaal, the king of the Zidonians. And the Bible says he went and served Baal and worshipped him. That's 1 Kings 16:31. Now, this woman that he got married to by the name of Jezebel, she is referred to in other parts of the Bible. The name of Jezebel was used to identify a wicked church during the Dark Ages that tried to destroy the Church of God. Now, the name of the church was called Thyatira. Now, if you're familiar with the churches in Revelation, there were seven churches, and according to Acts of the Apostles, and it's pretty clear on the characteristics, that each of those churches represented a period of time in the history of the Christian church. So Ephesus represented the apostolic church, and then Smyrna was the church under persecution, and then Pergamos was the church of compromise. And then you had Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and then the last church, what was the name of the last church?
Laodicea.
That's right, Laodicea. Now, the church of Thyatira represented the church of the Dark Ages from 538 down to 1517 when Luther nailed the 95 Theses on the door at Wittenberg Chapel in Germany. Well, to the church of Thyatira, it says this: "These things saith the Son of God, who hath his eyes like unto a flame of fire, his feet are like fine brass. I know thy works, charity, service, faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last to be more than the first." Now let's remember, during the Dark Ages, there were many powerful people that God used to spread his truth throughout the world, weren't there? Who were some of the people between 538 and 1517 that preached the truth? John Huss did, okay. John Wycliffe, okay. William Tyndale was a little bit after, Juanita, a little bit after. Who was the group of people that lived in the northern mountains? The Waldenses, that's right. So there were a lot of people, and in the book by B.G. Wilkinson called Truth Triumphant, he talks about Patrick, he talks about Columba, and a host of other men through that time who preached the truth all over the world. So there were some mighty, mighty Christians during that time. But Revelation 2:20 says, "Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols." So here was an evil woman. And throughout Scripture, what does an evil woman represent? A false church. So in the time of Thyatira, you had the true church of God. You had the Waldenses and Huss and Jerome and Wycliffe and the Lollards and Columba and Patrick and many other people. They were the true church preaching the truth for that time. But at the same time, there was this other group claiming to be teacher for God, claiming to be a prophetess, but they were actually seducing, trying to seduce the people of God to commit fornication. So they were trying to seduce God's people in joining up with the state church and having the church and state together. Now, who does Jezebel represent during the Dark Ages? Who was that?
It was the papacy.
It was the papacy. The Church of Thyatira, representing the church from 538 to 1517, was assaulted by Jezebel, a fitting symbol of the papal church that sought to destroy the people of God. Like oil and water, Ahab and Jezebel should have never united their lives. That's what it was like. You see, the two just don't mix. It was never meant that God's people should marry outside their faith. It was never meant to be that Adventism or Ahab should be united to Jezebel. Should have never been. What we're going to look at is what happens when Adventism and Catholicism unite forces as Ahab and Jezebel did. What happens when the two unite together? There's certain characteristics that we find in 1 Kings. Notice first off, 1 Kings 16 and verse 31, the Bible says, came to pass as if it had been a light thing for Ahab to walk in the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, that Ahab took to wife Jezebel. So there's your Adventist Catholic connection right there. The daughter of Ethbaal, king of the Zidonians. And what happened when they joined together? They went and served Baal and worshipped him. Now, in most encyclopedias, if you study about Baal, it tells you that it refers to any god, even to human officials. In some texts, it's used as a substitute for Hadad, a god of the rain, thunder, fertility, and agriculture, and the Lord of Heaven. Now, I remember my children's Bible books by Etta B. Dejering, the little My Bible Story book. There was a story about Elijah, and the very first picture, the very first page of that story, there was a picture of Ahab and a group of Israelites, and Ahab was saying, pray to Baal. Baal sends the rain to make your crops grow. But what attribute were the children of Israel giving to Baal? What were they calling him? They were saying he was the creator God. Yeah. To say that Baal sent the rain and was responsible for things growing, he was the very life giver and the creator. So the leader of Adventism had rejected the creator by worshiping Baal and was following a false god. In rejecting the creator, the sanctity of the Sabbath was gone too. Have we been warned? When Seventh-day Adventism and Catholicism unite together, the Sabbath is lightly regarded. Amen. The Sabbath is thrown out the window, and anything and everything goes on the Sabbath. In First Selected Messages, page 204 and 205, it says, the enemy of souls has sought to bring in the supposition that a great reformation was to take place among Seventh-day Adventists, and that this reformation would consist in giving up the doctrines which stand as the pillars of our faith and engaging in a process of reorganization. Were this reformation to take place, what would result? The principles of truth that God in His wisdom has given to the remnant church would be discarded. Our religion would be changed. The fundamental principles that have sustained the work for the last 50 years would be accounted as error. A new organization would be established. Books of a new order would be written. A system of intellectual philosophy would be introduced. That's right, bud. Books of a new order. Bibles of a new order.
Amen.
The founders of this system would go into the cities and do a wonderful work. Now, what about the Sabbath? The Sabbath would be lightly regarded as also to the God who created it. Nothing would be allowed to stand in the way of the new movement. The leaders would teach that virtue is better than vice, but God being removed, they would place their dependence on human power, which without God is worthless. Their foundation would be built on the sand, and storm and tempest would sweep away the structure. Seventh-day Adventism would accept the mark of the beast. You see, friends, where the apostasy in Adventism is leading today, it's not leading to the New Jerusalem. It's leading to Sunday. It's leading to Seventh-day Adventists embracing sun worship. That's where it's leading today. Here's a statement. Review and Herald, March 18, 1884. It says the Lord has a controversy with his professed people in these last days. Who are God's professed people in these last days?
Seventh-day Adventists.
Seventh-day Adventists. Those are the people professing to be God's people in these last days. In this controversy, men in responsible positions will take a course directly opposite to that pursued by Nehemiah. What do we call people in responsible positions?
Leaders.
Leaders. Pastors. Conference officials. Now it says they would take a course directly opposite to that pursued by Nehemiah. What did Nehemiah do? He repaired the breach. He rebuilt the wall that had been knocked down around Jerusalem. What does that wall represent?
The Sabbath. The Ten Commandments and the Sabbath.
Okay. Especially the entire law of God, but the Sabbath is definitely included in that.
Wasn't he the one that also closed the gates on the Sabbath and brought out the people trying to buy and sell?
Yes, right.
Absolutely, Kevin. Absolutely, he did.
He jerked their hair off.
Took them out by the hair.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. I wonder what we'd do if Nehemiah were here today. Yes, Kathy.
One other thing I was going to add, you were talking a while ago about the books of the New Order. My husband said, I don't remember as a gleaner or the Adventist Review because I didn't really look at it, but last weekend it was a new one. We just got in the mail. But there's an article in it, in the last magazine, they're rewriting the Spirit of Prophecy.
Yes,
okay. They're
going to
be putting out
new
books.
Right, yep. Yeah.
For those for the tape and for those that maybe couldn't hear, Kathy said you got a paper in the mail.
Was it Adventist Review?
I just read that. I don't remember. I think I read it online.
A conference paper where it said they're actually they're rewriting
the
Spirit of Prophecy books.
Well, what's the point?
To make them easier to understand.
For the young people.
Oh, that's what they said about
it. Well, they've already done that to one of us. That's why they got the New King James. It says they will not only ignore and despise the Sabbath themselves, but they will try to keep it from others by burying it beneath the rubbish of custom and tradition. In churches, now in the context of the quote, what churches is it talking about? Seventh-day Adventist churches. And in large gatherings in the open air, what do we call that?
Camp meetings.
Ministers, now what kind of ministers in the context?
Seventh-day
Adventist ministers will urge upon the people the necessity of keeping the first day of the week. So folks, this is where apostasy is heading. This is what, there's not going to be this snap of the finger reformation in the Seventh-day Adventist denomination. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. Where it's heading is, it's heading to Sunday keeping. Yes, ma'am.
Isn't there a statement that says there's more fear from within than without?
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, and your, what is your name?
Judy.
Judy's comment was, Ellen White made a statement, I don't know exactly where it is, Judy, but she did say that. We have more to fear from within than without. Now, folks, I want you to analyze this quote very carefully. At a recent meeting where I was, there were several conference people at the meeting. They were very upset when I stated this quote, and they said, that's not talking about Seventh-day Adventists, that's talking about apostate Protestants. So, read it, look at it, see if, you know, I think it's very clear. God's professed people, those are Seventh-day Adventists. Because it's, you know, Sunday keepers are bold and frank about the fact that they're seeking to tear down the Ten Commandments. But here you have a group of people that are simply saying, you know, we know what Nehemiah did, and they know about the Sabbath, but they're trying to keep it from others. So, I think it's pretty clear that this is talking about Seventh-day Adventists, and this is talking about where apostasy in Seventh-day Adventism will lead. You know, folks, with the almost superhuman efforts that are being made today in our country, in the Seventh-day Adventist movement at large, and throughout the world, there is this intense desire to make us believe that all evil today emanates from Islam. Now, if you haven't seen that, that's what's going on. There are Seventh-day Adventist pastors who are saying that today, that the Antichrist is not just the papacy, but it's also Islam. And folk, we are constantly, you know, I had a letter from a guy in Sarasota, Florida, after we sent out the brochure down there. And then he wrote in and got our books and DVDs. He said, I read through the Secret Terrorist book. He said, I read through the National Sunday Law book. I watched your DVDs. And he said, I'm sending them back to you. And he said, I am very disappointed in you because you did not tell people, you're not telling people in your literature who is really behind what's going on in the world. That's what he said. He said, yes, there are problems within Christendom, but he said the great enemy in our world today is Islam. Folk, we're hearing that all over.
Yes.
All over. And I want you to think for just a moment as to a possible scenario. A possible scenario. Right now in America, America is, and the world are so agitated because we have been told that some man was just killed. Mm-hmm. And what was the man's name? Osama bin Laden. Now, folks, think for a moment. Osama bin Laden is a symbol of terrorism. He's a symbol of that. So, for those people who believe that the terrorists are the, you know, the Muslims, don't you think the Muslims would now retaliate? Of course they would. Now, if we have some spiritual, well, I'm not going to say it that way. Let me see if I can put it a nice way. If we have some understanding about Bible prophecy, that sounded pretty good, didn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. If we have some understanding about Bible prophecy, we understand that the great Antichrist power at the end of time is not Islam, but it's the papacy.
Amen.
So if you were Rome, and you control the media, even though bin Laden probably didn't die a week ago, he probably died five, 10 years ago, really. You know, this would be a perfect time for there to be a terror attack in America, wouldn't it? Because in the aftermath, what would all the media and all the pastors and everybody, who would they say was at fault? They'd say, oh, Islam, look what they did. We've got to trounce them. But you know what would also be a perfect time? While everybody is seeing how evil Islam is and how destructive they've been on American soil, wouldn't it be a perfect time for rulers and Glenn Beck and Fox News and Newt Gingrich and televangelists to say, folk, the reason why this has happened and the reason why we're having these natural disasters and the reason why our economy is in such bad shape, it's because we're not following God. Amen. We've got to get back to God. And the way we do that is by setting up a Sunday law. Well, you know something? Would it just come out as a Sunday law?
No.
See, this indicates, folk, a time when things would get so heated up that Seventh-day Adventist ministers would urge Seventh-day Adventists of the necessity of keeping the first day of the week. Why? Because if Seventh-day Adventists don't, do you know what that means? That means there would be more terrorist attacks in America. That means there would be more natural disasters. That means that the economy would get worse. And so the people that would hold on to the Seventh-day Sabbath, they're the ones that are causing all of those evils. And so Seventh-day Adventist pastors, they would say, well, my, they're right. The evil is coming from Islam. And if we want God's favor as a nation, we've got to start keeping Sunday.
Unconverted Seventh-day Adventist pastors.
That's right, Juanita. You know, in this statement that I was given, this is called a special document from the Vatican, Agenda for the Evangelization of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It says the sectarian group most coveted. Evangelize the Seventh-day Adventists with true evangelism, which constitutes the major accomplishment of the Catholic Church to return the Protestants to the bosom of Rome. Infiltrate Adventism with ideas and projects that forms a union between Catholics and Adventists. Make concessions that will join them together. Now down at the bottom it says, Seventh-day Adventists must understand that by not uniting to search jointly, Catholics and Protestants working together under the New World Order, the Seventh-day Adventists will be blamed for all the calamities and all the disasters that are coming upon the earth. How is it that a pseudo Seventh-day Adventist pastor could urge Seventh-day Adventists to accept the mark of the beast? Well, it's to save America. To save America in sin. And that's how it will happen. I believe that's how it will happen. So the Sabbath would be lightly regarded. Eventually, pseudo Seventh-day Adventist pastors will urge Seventh-day Adventists to accept the mark of the beast. In rejecting the Sabbath, Ahab and Adventism, they cast off Christ and his power to save from sin. Why? Because the Sabbath is a sign of that experience. Ezekiel 20 verse 12 tells us, I gave them my Sabbath to be a sign between me and them, that they might know that I am the Lord that sanctify them. So the Sabbath is a sign of the power of Jesus Christ to save us from our sins. what the Sabbath is all about. So if you reject the Sabbath, you reject sanctification, because the two go together. And so somebody may say, well, you have no proof of Seventh-day Adventism rejecting the message of sanctification. Well, folk, there was a book written back in the early 1990s. It was called Issues, the Seventh-day Adventist Church and Certain Private Ministries. You know, it was this right here. It was this right here that basically drove me out of the Seventh-day Adventist denomination. Because I would go into Sabbath school classes in Red Bluff, California, and I would quote this in my class. And I would say, folk, a Seventh-day Adventist did not write this. This could not have been written by a Seventh-day Adventist. And the wealthy people that were sitting in my Sabbath school class, they didn't like that. There was a multimillionaire dentist. And when I would share that in Sabbath school the following Tuesday or Monday, he would call the conference office and he'd say, you shut Bill Hughes' mouth or I will not put another dime into your coffers. Well, listen to this quote, folk. It's talking about Hope International, which at that time was an extremely prominent independent ministry. It says, the real problem is that Hope International has certain views on the human nature of Christ, the nature of sin, and sanctification. So there's our issue of sanctification. And if you attack sanctification, you attack the Sabbath, because the Sabbath is a sign of sanctification. Actually, if you attack sanctification, then you've attacked the sanctuary, because that's what the sanctuary teaches. And if you attack the sanctification, then you've attacked the power of the Holy Spirit, because that's the purpose of the Holy Spirit, is to help us overcome sin. And if you attack sanctification, you have to attack the spirit of prophecy, because that's so much of what Ellen White talks about. So to attack sanctification is to attack the very rationale of Seventh-day Adventism. Well, this is what it says. So the real problem is that Hope International has certain views on the nature of Christ, the human nature, the nature of sin and sanctification. These issues have never been settled among Christians, much less among Seventh-day Adventists. You mean we don't know it? We don't know what our understanding of sanctification is? We don't know the importance of allowing Christ to give us victory in our lives? Folk, if we don't know that, we're in trouble. If we get confused over sanctification, well, then the dominoes start to fall. These issues, they are not so essential. They are not so essential to salvation that souls will be lost unless they're resolved. Is sanctification essential to our salvation?
Amen.
Yes. Absolutely. To every one of the seven churches, it says, to him that overcometh will I give to eat of the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. To him that he that overcometh shall not be hurt of the second death. To him that overcometh I will give him a white stone, and in that white stone will be a new name written. To him that overcometh I will clothe in white raiment, and I will not blot his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me on my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down on my Father in his throne. Is overcoming essential to salvation?
Amen.
Absolutely. And this statement, These are not essential to salvation, that souls will be lost. Oh, yes, they will be lost. The problem that Hope International has created, did Hope International create the problem?
No.
No, they didn't. No, they didn't. The denomination created the problem by saying that these were not important issues. They created the problem. It says, has created it is that this independent ministry feels driven to charge the SDA Church with being in a state of apostasy because it does not accept their views on these moot theological issues. Do you know what moot means?
Worthless.
Means worthless. Not uncircumstantial. Doesn't make any difference. That's what moot means. So the Seventh-day Adventist denomination back in 1992 stated that sanctification doesn't make any difference at all. And again, if sanctification doesn't make any difference, the Sabbath doesn't make any difference, the sanctuary, the spirit of prophecy, the state of the dead, the three angels' messages, with this one statement, folks, right here in this book, Issues, the Seventh-day Adventist Church and Certain Private Ministries, this book made of no effect the very movement of Seventh-day Adventism.
The pillars of our faith.
The pillars of our faith. You know what, folks? It was in the summer of 1992 that I was fired. Right there.
Thank God.
Amen. You know, it's Ben. What is your name?
Don't worry about it.
It's Bill, isn't it? That's right. You know, Bill, when I was fired, I was teaching in a one-room school in Red Bluff, California.
I know it.
12 children in the school.
That's right. You left the pension, the whole works.
Yeah. You know what? When I first became a Seventh-day Adventist, the one thing I wanted to do was to spread the three angels' messages around the world.
Amen. Amen.
And I begin teaching and pastoring in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I end up in a one-room school in a town of 10,000 people out in the middle of nowhere. If you've ever been in Red Bluff, it's in the middle of nowhere. Now, I love Red Bluff. I loved it there. But, Bill, I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, and I would pray and say, Lord, you promised if I would delight myself in you, you would give me the desire of my heart. And I said, Lord, I love teaching and I love working with children, but that was not the desire of my heart. I wanted to spread the truth of the three angels all over the world, but I can't do that in this little classroom. Well, Bill, you know what happened? I was fired in 1992, and in 1995 till now, I have had the privilege of sending out materials on the three angels' messages to the tune of over 8 million pieces of literature around the world. Praise God.
Is the Lord still using you?
I believe he is, Bill.
I believe he is too.
God is good. Oh my. Oh my. 1 Kings 16:32, it says, and he, Ahab, reared up an altar for Baal in the house of Baal, which he had built in Samaria. By setting up a house for Baal, this was supplanting the true sanctuary in Jerusalem and everything that the sanctuary taught. When Adventism and Catholicism unite, the law of God disappears. Sanctification disappears, and the sanctuary and all it teaches disappears. An attack on the sanctuary? Would that include an attack on the atonement? Would that include an attack on 1844? Would that include an attack on the ministry of Christ in the most holy place since 1844? No teaching in Seventh-day Adventism has been more assaulted than this one. This fundamental teaching has been assaulted by Froom and Anderson in the book Questions on Doctrine. It was assaulted by Desmond Ford in the 70s and 80s, and it is being assaulted today by the denials and refusals to even discuss this teaching of Seventh-day Adventists. You know, I'll never forget the last conference church that I attended before I was fired. The pastor in the church there, it was in Anderson, California, which is just north of Red Bluff. The man was getting so much pressure from his elders and the church board to give a presentation on the three angels' messages. He was actually having to be pressured to do it because he didn't want to. Well, folks, he started going through the three angels' messages and he talked about fear God and give glory to Him. And when he got to give glory to Him, after he went through that, he then jumped to and worship Him that made heaven and earth and the sea and the fountains of waters. And I looked and I asked my wife, I said, Hoda, I thought he was doing a series on the three angels' messages. She said, he is. I said, but what happened for the hour of his judgment has come? He just left it out. Mm-hmm. Folk, there is a shame. There is a shameful denial of that truth among us as a people. We don't understand it. It's very sad. It's very sad. But that's what's happened when Catholicism and Adventism unite together. The issue and the purpose and the message of the sanctuary disappears. Yes, ma'am.
In the New Adventist hymnal, have you ever sing the song Rock of Ages Cleft for Me?
Sure.
It no longer has the judgment throne, it has the heavenly throne. They've changed the words. See thee on thy heavenly throne, not see thee on thy judgment throne.
Interesting.
Is that Rock of Ages you say?
Mm-hmm. That's in the New Adventist hymnal.
Back at the turn of the century, this famous Seventh-day Adventist doctor took a pot shot at the doctrine of the sanctuary when he promoted a book called The Living Temple. And in The Living Temple, he promoted an idea. What was the idea promoted in The Living Temple?
Pantheism.
Pantheism. And Ellen White makes the comment, she says, those who entertain these sophistries will soon find themselves in a position where the enemy can talk with them and lead them away from God. It's represented to me that the writer of this book is on a false track. He has lost sight of the distinguishing truths for this time. He knows not whither his steps are tending. The track of truth lies close beside the track of error. Both tracks may seem to be one to minds which are not worked by the Holy Spirit, and which therefore are not quick to discern the difference between truth and error. Folk, the distinguishing truths that John Harvey Kellogg lost sight of in his doctrine on pantheism was the message of the sanctuary, because if God is in everything, then there is no need for a God to be enthroned in the most holy place. There is no reason for angels to be going to and fro. Why do we even need angels?
Or a high priest.
Or a high priest. Because God is in us. So Kellogg's book on pantheism was a direct assault on the sanctuary. And it was pantheism. Kellogg's pantheistic teachings, claiming that God was in everything, was a direct shot at the heavenly sanctuary where God is enthroned. If God is everywhere, what need is there for a temple in heaven wherein for God to dwell? Ellen White referred to Kellogg's teaching as the alpha of deadly heresies, and she trembled because Omega would come and would seek the destruction of God's remnant people. I don't know how many of you have read this book, The Omega Rebellion. Have any of you read that book? Yeah. You need to get it. The Omega Rebellion. The man who wrote it, his name is Rick Howard. It's put out by Remnant Publications in Michigan. Rick Howard was, I believe he's retired now, but he was a Seventh-day Adventist pastor in the denomination for over 30 years. And as you read his book, as I did, Rick Howard desperately, in his book, is trying so hard to say how wonderful it is to be a part of the denomination. He says that repeatedly in his book. The reason he does that, folk, is because he has to say some very difficult things about what is going on in the denomination today. This is what he says. The concept of God is revealed to Loyola, that's the founder of the Jesuit order, the Black Papacy, in the 1530s. It says, in these mystical experiences, reveal a God who is what?
Pantheistic.
So the spiritual exercises of the founder of the Jesuit order, those spiritual exercises were pantheistic in their nature. John Harvey Kellogg, in the early 1900s, was writing pantheistic teachings in his book, Living Temple. Howard goes on, he says, Loyola developed what is called today his spiritual exercises, which contain all the teachings from which modern, look at this, spiritual formation was constructed. From these spiritual exercises comes the most important practice of the examine. A daily practice of prayer and meditation essential to spiritual formation. According to Howard, Ignatius Loyola, the Jesuit founder, pantheism and spiritual formation all go together. Loyola's understanding of God was pantheistic. From his understanding of God, he derived his spiritual exercises, which is the foundation for the spiritual formation movement of today. But what does Loyola's spiritual exercises and spiritual formation have to do with Adventism and the Omega? What do those have to do with each other? Look at this, folk. This is quoted in Rick Howard's book, The Omega Rebellion, page 136. He says, please prayerfully consider this quotation from a general conference bulletin informing the church at large of its plans to implement the teaching of what?
Spiritual formation
around the world. Rick Howard says the General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists is going to implement spiritual formation around the world, teaching all Seventh-day Adventists spiritual formation. Now, folk, that was done. Look at this. The Adventist World Church created the International Board of Ministerial and Theological Education when? September of 2001. Designed to provide overall guidance and standards to the professional training of pastors, evangelists, theologians, teachers, chaplains, and other denominational employees involved in ministerial and religious formation. Or what?
Spiritual
formation. In each of the church's 13 regions around the world. The pantheistic teachings of Ignatius Loyola, the founder of the Jesuit order, has been taught to Seventh-day Adventist leaders for the last 10 years. The last 10 years. Jack.
How about Rick Warren's books? I noticed some of the Adventist churches here have been using them too, and isn't that kind of on the same?
No. Rick Warren is completely different, Jack. Rick Warren is the pastor of the Saddleback Church. It's down somewhere south. Near San Diego? Okay. And he, Jack, is seeking to be a part of bringing all the churches together in a one ecumenical unity. Into spiritual formation. That's who Rick Warren is. Rick Howard, completely different. Completely different, Jack. And in fact, Jack, what if you can tell from Rick Howard's book, The Omega Rebellion, he is warning Seventh-day Adventists against pantheism, against Kellogg, against Loyola, and he's even declaring what the denomination is doing in allowing and bringing in spiritual formation among Seventh-day Adventists. Now, what's this all about? Folks, this is directly tied to spiritual formation. It's directly tied to Seventh-day Adventists becoming a part of the one-world ecumenical unity. Before the early 1980s, the Seventh-day Adventist logo was what?
Three angels
with trumpets. In 1982, the Seventh-day Adventist denomination was a part of an ecumenical World Council of Churches meeting in Lima, Peru. And at that meeting, there were three issues that all the churches agreed on. B-E-M, Juanita, that's right. There were three issues. How many wavy lines are there?
Three.
There's three. The three issues were B for baptism, E for Eucharist, and M for
ministry.
B-E-M. Now all the churches agreed at that meeting that it doesn't matter how you baptize people. You can sprinkle them, you can dip them, you can do it however you want to. It doesn't make any difference. Do you know, folk, during the 16th and 17th century, thousands of people died because they said, we will not have our children sprinkled. They were called Anabaptists. Ulrich Zwingli, a great controversy, has a lot of good to say about Ulrich Zwingli, because in the beginning, Ulrich Zwingli was a mighty reformer for God, and he sought to bring people back to Scripture. But after a time, Ulrich Zwingli stopped. He stopped reforming. And there were people who he had brought to Scripture, and they said, Ulrich, show us infant baptism in the Bible. He said, it's not there. He said, then why are you still doing it? He said, because if we don't baptize the infants, it will disrupt the social order in Zurich. So he continued to baptize babies. Well, some of his followers refused to go along with him. And you know what? He had them drowned. He had them drowned because they were rebaptized. These were adults. They were rebaptized by immersion.
They used drowning because of it.
That's right. They called it the third baptism. Yeah. Well, folk, so people died over baptism. Eucharist, the E in the document. What that basically said was, you can believe whatever you want on the Eucharist. If you think that Christ's body and blood are actually in those emblems and the priest has the power to recreate Christ in those emblems, that's fine, no problem. If you want to think that Christ is there spiritually, because the priest or the pastor has invoked his name, you can believe that. Or you can believe that the whole service is symbolic, that the bread represents is symbolic of Christ's body and the juice is symbolic of Christ's blood. You can believe any one of those. It's okay. That's what this document said. And ministry, that said, you can go out and you can witness to people who used to be in your church. But you don't
witness to people in other churches. You don't do that. You don't proselytize. That's right. Well, the Seventh-day Adventist signed the document named Raoul Dederin. Raoul Dederin was raised a devout Catholic, became a quote-unquote Seventh-day Adventist theologian. He was at that conference in 1982 when the BDM document was signed. Now, folks, sometime after 1982, all of a sudden, the book from that conference came out. Now guess what the logo is on the front of this BDM document? Guess what it is? It's three wavy lines. Now on that book, they go like this, okay? But there's three wavy lines. Sometime after the publishing of that book and after that conference, the Seventh-day Adventist denomination changed their logo. And it became this. Now, Doug Batchelor, and again, I apologize for mentioning names. I have nothing personally against Doug Batchelor, okay? I know Doug. Nothing personally against him. But Doug was not telling people the truth. A lady in New Zealand, when I showed this slide, after the meeting, she came up to me and she said, "That doesn't represent the BEM document. Doug Batchelor said that represents the three angels' messages."
No.
I said, "Ma'am, Doug did not tell you the truth.
No.
That does not represent three angels' messages."
Absolutely not.
Bill, what about the cross in the middle?
You know, Marilyn, a lady in New Zealand, she showed me that's actually an upside down cross.
Yes.
It's an upside down cross.
Yeah.
This is the top. It actually comes up like this, ma'am.
Wow. Wow.
You can't see it, no. But it's actually an upside down cross.
It looks like right side up.
It looks like right side up. But it's actually
a
satanic symbol. I hesitated to put that picture in here, but it's gruesome, isn't it? It's sickening. What you have is a man whose eyes have literally almost been pulled out. One of the things that happens when Adventism and Catholicism unite, I want you to notice 1 Kings 18, 12 and 13. When Elijah was going to meet Ahab, Elijah met Obadiah. You remember the Ahab's general? And Elijah said to Obadiah, he said, "Go and tell Ahab I'm coming to meet him." And Obadiah said, "Oh no, as soon as I leave, you're going to disappear. And then Ahab will kill me." And then Obadiah pleads with Elijah and he says this, he says, "Was it not told my Lord what I did when Jezebel slew the prophets of the Lord? How I hid 100 men of the Lord's prophets by 50 in a cave and fed them with bread and water?" What happens when Catholicism and Adventism unite? The prophets are slain. Prophets are slain. Jezebel slew the prophets of the Lord. Catholic Adventism plucks out the eyes of the movement. The eyes of Adventism are the messages of the prophet. Ellen White is so subtly attacked by these comments. "I believe in the Bible only. She's good for pastoral counseling, but not for doctrine. Her writings were good a century ago, but not now. She's too strict. We need to lighten up. We slay her by acting as though her books don't exist by our neglect of them." You know, folk, when I was in New Zealand, I had several people after the meeting that Saturday night, they came up to me and they said, "You've never visited in our churches, but you were telling us verbatim what our pastors have been telling us for decades. These very words, folk. One thing is certain, third selected messages, page 84. Those Seventh-day Adventists who take their stand under Satan's banner will first give up their faith in the warnings and reproofs contained in the testimonies of God's Spirit. That's third selected messages, page 84. The very last deception of Satan will be to make of none effect the testimony of the Spirit of God. Satan will work ingeniously in different ways through different agencies to unsettle the confidence of God's remnant people in the true testimony. The last thing, and this is, I'll just tell you the story. It's 1 Kings 21, 1-15. You remember when Ahab went to Naboth, the man who owned the vineyard right next to Ahab's palace? And Ahab said, Naboth, sell me your vineyard. And Naboth said, no, that vineyard has belonged to my ancestors for centuries. And so Ahab went home like a spoiled brat. And what did he do? He went to his room, and when the servant brought his meal, he put his face to the wall. And he was bubbling, and his lips were quivering, and he said, I don't want to eat. You know, just like a spoiled brat. And so then Jezebel comes in and says, why are you crying? And Ahab said, because Naboth won't give me that vineyard. You won't sell it to me. And Jezebel says, don't worry. Let's have dinner. I'll make sure I'll get it for you. So what did Jezebel do? When Adventism and Catholicism unite, what did Jezebel do? She contacted the local government where Naboth lived, and she said, you bring Naboth out, you set him up on high, you get false witnesses to accuse him, and then you kill him. When Adventism and Catholicism unite, government is always used to enforce what they want. Now the young man on the left, Rafael Perez, West Palm Beach, Florida. Rafael put an ad in the USA Today in Washington, D.C. A Catholic priest was furious with what he had done. The priest contacted the General Conference, told them to shut him up. He was then taken to court. He lost his first case in Miami. He then appealed it to the next court of justice, which would be in Atlanta. But between the Miami and the Atlanta trial, there were some very wealthy Seventh-day Adventist doctors in Loma Linda, California, who learned about this court case. So they contacted the General Conference and said, we won't give you another dime until you stop this trial. Well, right after that, the court case was stopped. The point being, folk, Seventh-day Adventism and Catholicism today have united together. And when people, as Rafael Perez seeks to share the truth through an ad in the newspaper, to try to warn people as to what is coming on the world to prepare for the coming of Christ, he was taken to court for that. Great Controversy 608, as the storm approaches, a large class who have professed faith in the third angel's message, those are Seventh-day Adventists, but have not been sanctified. See, the book Issues, they said it wasn't a important issue. It was moot. But Ellen White was quite clear on how important sanctification is. She says, they profess faith in the third angel's message, but they have not been sanctified through obedience to the truth. Abandon their position and join the ranks of the opposition. Now, does it say they leave the church?
No.
Does it say they leave the organization?
No.
No, it doesn't say that. It says they abandon their position. What does that mean? It means they turn away from the truths that make them Seventh-day Adventists, and while they stay right in the denomination, they now join up with the opposition. They begin to believe just as all the other churches believe. By uniting with the world and partaking of its spirit, they've come to view matters in nearly the same light. And when the test is brought, what's the test?
Sunday law.
Sunday law is brought, they are prepared to choose the easy, popular side. Well, right here, Ellen White says, a large class of Seventh-day Adventists abandon their belief on our great truths, join up with the apostate Protestant churches and Roman Catholicism, and when the Sunday test comes, they're already ready to choose the easy, popular side. Men of talent and pleasing address who once rejoiced in the truth employ their powers to deceive and mislead souls. They become the most bitter enemies of their former brethren. When Sabbath keepers are brought before the courts to answer for their faith, these apostates are the most efficient agents of Satan to misrepresent and accuse them, and by false reports and insinuations to stir up the rulers against them. Sometimes folk in independent Seventh-day Adventist meetings, when we discuss denominational apostasy, we kind of get real cozy. We better not. Folk, in ancient Adventism, there were two extreme groups. There were two extremes. There were the very liberal Sadducees. And the Sadducees, they threw out the judgment, they threw out the resurrection, they threw out the doctrine that there were angels. So they threw out fundamental Seventh-day Adventist teaching. That's what the Sadducees did. On the other extreme, there were the Pharisees. And the Pharisees were fanatical. They were fanatical on certain beliefs, but in spirit, they were completely void of the Spirit of God. And you know what? Throughout the ministry of Christ, those two extremes were at constant odds with each other. Remember that? Constantly at odds. But when it came time for the trial of Christ, they joined together. Now, the followers of Christ today are those that hold on to the fundamental teachings of Seventh-day Adventists under the control of the Holy Spirit. Those are the followers of Christ. The two extremes, folk, will one day unite together. They will unite together. And the great issue, because those who walk with Christ in that balance of fundamental doctrine with the Spirit leading in their life, folk, those people will be persecuted. They will be persecuted. And those that make up that group will come from denominational Adventism and from independent Adventism. You know, when we draw the lines, we like to draw the lines, and I've done it. I like to draw the lines in the sand and say, all the independents are in. All the denomination is out. Uh-uh. It's not that way. It's not that way. It comes down to, are we holding on to our teachings with the power of the Holy Spirit guiding in our lives? Amen. That's the core issue. That's the core issue.
Sanctified through obedience to the truth.
Absolutely, Chris. sanctified by obedience to the truth. Those that are will go on to glory. This is the group. This is the ship that's going through. Those who are sanctified by obedience to the truth. That's the ship that's going to paradise.
Amen.
Let's go ahead and have prayer together.